In this video, we're going to look at a few different types of bird and a few different types of aircraft, all with the goal of answering the question, who does it better, bird flight versus human flight? Let's get to it. There are a few problems or difficulties when comparing different aircraft together. The first is that aircraft are very mission dependent. This means that it is designed to perform a specific task or a set of tasks that are closely related to each other. And so it's hard to adapt an aircraft to a different set of requirements or a different mission that is very different from its original. For instance, if I showed you a picture here of a small lightweight Cessna and an SR-71 Blackbird and asked you which one was better for crop dusting, the obvious answer is going to be the aircraft on the left. The small Cessna is going to be better for that new task or that new mission. Now, this is a problem when we're trying to compare different aircraft or even aircraft to birds. Instead of looking at aircraft and trying to find the best aircraft and comparing it to the best bird, what we're going to do is kind of generalize it and look at different flight parameters of different aircraft as sort of capabilities of general bird flight or general human flight. And we're actually going to go ahead and leave rockets out of this. Rockets and rocket planes generally produce most of their lift from their huge engine in the vehicle. I'm not wanting to go that direction with this video, so we're going to go ahead and stick with aircraft that are generating most of their lift with the wings. So, general aircraft. There's another problem when trying to compare aircraft, and that is the size difference. To try and explain what is meant by this, I have a question for you. If I have a wing design, right, a wing shape, if I double the size of that wing, and because of that it produces twice as much lift, does that mean the design is twice as good? And if I wanted to compare it to a different aircraft wing design, how am I going to know which is the better design if all I need to do is just double it to get more lift? This is the reason that in aerospace engineering, we often normalize the parameter that we're looking at by a common value, a common parameter, so that we can better assess what is a better design. For instance, if I wanted to compare the lift and drag that a wing produces to find out which is the better designed wing, the lift will actually be normalized by the planform area, thereby creating a standard by which I can measure either the same wing or a different wing at a different size. For instance, if I normalized my wing by the planform area, then the lift would double if I doubled the planform area. However, the coefficient of lift, right, the normalized lift, would not double, it would remain the same. And so what we can do is we can compare this normalized lift, right, the coefficient of lift of this wing I have over here versus a different wing, and we can assess what is the better design. And so when we're trying to compare bird flight and human flight in this video, we're going to go ahead and do something similar. We're going to try and normalize the different flight parameters so that we're comparing the different designs and taking out some of the effects of the scaling issues that arise due to the difference in size of most birds and most aircraft. Let's go ahead and look at the first flight parameter, which is how high can we fly? Now, when looking at how high we can fly, let's go ahead and just choose the height of the bird versus the height of the human to normalize and compare the two against each other. So if we look at the highest an aircraft has flown, we have a record flight of 123,520 feet back in 1977 from a MiG-25. If we take this record height of the flight and divide that by the height of the aircraft or the height of, let's just say, a person of 6 feet, you'll see that in a MiG-25, humans can obtain more or less 20 to 1,000 times our height. However, if you look at a mallard duck, they have been observed flying at 21,000 feet. If you take as an average height 10 inches, you'll see it can obtain up to 25,000 times its height. So when we normalize based on height, we can actually find birds that can fly higher than we can in aircraft.
Now, the duck isn't the bird that can fly the highest. That actually goes to the Ruppel's griffon vulture. This thing has been observed flying at 37,000 feet. That's up there where commercial airliners fly. That's crazy. That's really high up there.
All right, let's go ahead and look at how fast we can fly. The record airspeed for an aircraft was the SR-71 Blackbird, traveling at 2,193 miles per hour back in 1976. That's up there about Mach 3-ish. If you divide that by the aircraft length of a 107 feet, you'll see that when we hop into an SR-71 Blackbird, we're able to obtain about 30 body lengths per second. However, if you look at a common pigeon, which is able to obtain a flight of 22.4 meters per second, they're able to get, based on their average length, about 75 body lengths per second. Just your common pigeon. Now let's look at some of the high performance birds. You've got your European starling. That can get up to about 120 body lengths per second. That's four times as fast as a blackbird if you scale it back to their size. That's pretty impressive. Now I've got to give an honorable mention as well to another flying animal. It's not quite a bird, but maybe we'll have another video talking about bat flight. The Brazilian free-tailed bat is now the record holder in terms of observed flying animals. It has been observed flying at 99.5 miles per hour. Now you have to remember this sustained flight. There are other birds who might obtain a faster flight, but that's usually in some sort of dive. And so this Brazilian bat was able to, based on its average total length, achieve approximately 473 body lengths per second. Next time that you're watching football, or soccer, or baseball, just imagine how different those sports would be if humans could travel 473 body lengths per second. And go ahead and drop a comment below if you want to see some videos on bats and bat flight in future videos. If we try and look at maneuverability in terms of roll rate, you'll see that a highly maneuverable aircraft, the A4 Skyhawk, was able to get 720 degrees per second, while the barn swallow is able to get, they say, 5,000 degrees per second, which is astronomical. I didn't feel the need to normalize these because both have to go through 360 degrees for one full revolution, so I don't normalize these. But as you can see, just looking at the total values here, the birds win this one. We don't just have to look at flight performance values. We can also look at G-loading as if we were trying to see structurally how much maneuvering or how much loading can the different aircraft or different birds handle. For general aviation, we usually see a value of 4 to 5 Gs. With military, that can go up to 8 to 10 Gs. However, it has been estimated that some Peregrine Falcons, when they do the nose over entering into a dive, can see up to 15 Gs. So not only do they have a pretty amazing structure that is able to withstand high loading, they're also able to stay conscious without needing any of the tricks that we do, like pressure suits. So let's go ahead and look at endurance. And I will admit, this is the one that surprised me the most in doing the research for and the creation of this video. Endurance is how long can you stay in the air, right? It's not about distance, it's about time. Recently, within the past year or two, the Airbus Zephyr, a solar-powered unmanned vehicle, was able to set a new record for endurance at 25 days, 23 hours, and 57 minutes, just shy of 26 days. Scientists have also discovered that the common swift can be in flight without landing for up to 10 months. This value was actually obtained via experiment. They attached sensors to these birds, let it fly around, do its thing, come home, and then they got the sensors and looked at the data. Now, you might ask, how in the world does that bird stay in the air for 10 months at a time? Doesn't it ever get tired or hungry? Well, these birds actually eat in the air, they sleep in the air. So let's go ahead and look at range. Range is a distance thing. How far can you go before you land? This record was set recently in 2006, where the pilot was able to travel 41,400 kilometers before landing. If you divide that by the average height of 6 foot, that gives about 22.7 million body lengths. If you divide that by the aircraft length, it's going to be a lot less than that. And if you look at hummingbirds, it is believed that hummingbirds can fly up to 1,370 miles without landing. However, when you take into account that their average body length is 3 inches, that gives you a value of 28.9 million body lengths before it actually has to touch down and land. Pretty crazy, if you ask me. So, what is the conclusion from this short, fun video on bird flight versus human flight? Well, we see that when you take size into account, birds can fly higher, faster, farther, longer, quicker, and maneuver a lot better than we can in our own aircraft. That's probably part of the reason why McMaster's and Henderson said once, "Humans fly commercially or recreationally, but animals fly professionally." As an aerospace engineer, it might be beneficial to look at birds and see how they're able to do this thing that we call flight, how they're able to do it so well, and see if maybe we can start closing the gap between bird flight and human flight. Now, I spent a few hours researching this subject and creating this video. So if you liked it, return the favor. Give me a like, give me a comment, or more importantly, subscribe to the channel.